I come to this as a practitioner rather than an academic, and much of this has arisen out of my recent experience of coming to a rural area rather than in urban diverse communities. During the first lockdown in the UK, the Diocese of Hereford, which I'm now in, held Zoom discussions entitled Racial Justice and the Church. It was their response to the re-emergence of the Black Lives Matter movement. And as a priest who moved to Craven Arms, a small agricultural town in Hereford, after ministry in urban communities, it was heartening to realise that these same rural communities were addressing issues that were part of my urban experience. The third of these sessions was by broadcaster and writer Dr. Joel Edwards, who suggested the need for a creation of safe spaces where white people could be set free from his quote, white liberal nervousness of getting things wrong. As someone involved in interfaith relations, I'm aware that issues of intolerance and racism are encountered within and across different faiths, not least the long history of anti-Semitism within the church. These comments then are a reflection of my vision of a safe place in relation to interfaith dialogue and the issues of racism. I've chosen to write of a safe place rather than space, as this may be significant in the current pandemic. The restrictions on people meeting, worship and prayer being held online, and the loss of communal life appear to diminish the importance of place. Some have lost their workplace. The division between separation of work and home places, and also the loss of meeting places. Online conversations and meetings have provided opportunities, yet we read and hear reports of where the lockdown has renewed commitment to localities, to local shops and businesses, reawakened awareness of local needs and opportunities. A sense of place, therefore, remains important. There is considerable debate regarding the meaning of place over against space. Yet it is the interaction and the association of people and place that gives it significance. Place is the opportunity to be communal and to act communally. My one example is that I cannot shut my neighbour's chickens in at night when she's away virtually. You have to go into her garden and get them into the hen coop. During this pandemic, creating a safe place has taken on a different resonance. Social distance, shielding the vulnerable, and preventing infection have been priorities. Before this, a safe place has often been associated with often somewhere where victims or survivors of abuse, particularly women, children, minorities, and vulnerable groups, can come together to find support, build resistance, share experience with confidence and without judgment. Interfaith dialogue has not, in my experience, sought to be a safe place in this sense. Rather, it is a place of trust, exploration, and growth in understanding. Not always comfortable, but rather a place of challenge and change. Among the reasons that the Interfaith Network lists for being involved in dialogue are tackling prejudice and countering hatred, and looking for ways to work together for the common good on a sound foundation of understanding. Faith identity is part of who we are, but so is the experience of racism and prejudice. John Wilkinson, in his book, The Church in Black and White, contends that black and white are terms in relation to racism, and in particular to colonial history, transatlantic slavery, and present racism experienced by black people in a white-dominated society. It is in this context that I'm using the terms black and white. It is not about our humanity. And the Race Gallery by Marek Cohn in the 1990s, and more recently Adam Rutherford, How to Argue with a Racist, exposed the pseudoscience that racism is based on. As I reflect on my identity as a white person, my earliest memories growing up in a working class area of Luton include black people living in the next street, friends of the family who were black, and seeing black people in and around the town. In my senior school years, I moved to my father's home village in rural Essex, where few black people lived. It was the civil rights marches and music in the 60s that provided my consciousness of racism. I remember listening to Josh White singing Strange Fruit, a song about public lynching of black people in the USA, having a particular impact. Later, a black work colleague loaned me a copy of the prison letters of George Jackson, sold out brother, and I began to think about racism and me. The TV series based on Alex Haley's book, Roots, was being shown at this time and was raising black consciousness among young people I was working with in Wolverhampton, stimulating discussion in the classroom and fights in the playground. As a Christian, I was aware of the experiences of Caribbean migrants whose experience of racism in the churches, and met some of the leaders of the then largest black majority churches, the New Testament Church of God. They have their own stories of encountering racism in churches in England, but it was listening to the experience of black Anglicans that made me aware of deeply entrenched racism in the church. Few Church of England congregations were safe places for black Anglicans. They challenged me to look at myself, my church, my faith, through listening to their story, seeing their resilience, their faith, and willingness to help me understand how racism works, was and is one of the deepest and most unsettling experiences in my personal journey of faith. This became more apparent when I was ordained and served in parishes where many black Anglicans were present. Organisations are obligated to have policies to promote equality and tackle racism. Yet it's not easy to be aware of how insidious racism is in our lives. The existence of racism makes me less of a person. In dialogue, I have to show a commitment to challenge all human diminishment of which racism is a part. My personhood is bound up with the personhood of others. To not act in a racist way is inadequate. I must challenge racism and seek to change myself and society. The experience of racial disadvantage also means there is one of racial advantage. This too, I must challenge. A friend recently put it this way. Where I am from for most of my life, especially my youth, most places I lived or went to, I was one of the only black people. I was attacked several times in primary school by white children who hated my skin. There were some parts of my town where, as mixed race black children, we knew we were not welcome. You never forget that feeling as we walked through areas in fear. You learn to live with it like grief. When I first visited my London cousins, I could not believe there were so many people who looked like me, just going about their daily business. It felt nice not to stand out, and I felt normal for the first time in years. I went to a club in London with my cousins and a guy who worked with them. The club was almost entirely black and the guy was white. As we were going in, the guy said he felt really weird being the only white person he could see. We assured him and said that it was a feeling of you is just in one club, one night. Welcome to my life. If you're wondering, I think this is what people mean by white privilege. How lovely it must be. I'm not looking for sympathy or to take anything from your own experiences. That won't bring back a childhood blighted by racism or stop the doubt in the back of my mind that I try to suppress. Even now, as a 50-year-old, every single time I walk through a village or town I don't know. But to my white friends and family, I say this. Please challenge racism where you can. Don't leave it to me. It is important that I, as a white person, own the reality of past and present racism. It is not a guilt trip. Rather, I have to critically evaluate myself, society, and its history. Resist racism now and build new relationships. As a Christian involved in dialogue, where other participants experience racism, I draw on the gospel story of the disciples of Jesus after they had forsaken him. His appearance to them in the upper room begins with the word peace. He does not say, I forgive you. There is no recrimination. He's offering a new relationship, not founded on their past failure, nor on forgetting what has happened, but on the possibility of a new beginning. Former Archbishop Rowan Williams defines oppression as the transaction that leads to exclusion, to the severance of reciprocity. The possibility of true mutuality means I will need to listen, learn, and continually develop a critical awareness of racism. Any safe place must lead to inclusion and restore reciprocity. Black Lives Matter in the context of interfaith dialogue has renewed my commitment to this pursuit of justice. It is my hope that we take this challenge with renewed vigor. Dialogue continues to give me some of the richest experiences of my life and some of the deepest challenges to my faith, my assumptions, culture, and values. Joel Edwards encouraged those sharing in the discussions to find out the historic background of racism. With this comes the realization that something of our spiritual foundation has been built on racism. Exposing ourselves to a new culture, history, and identity and faith can open the way for the purging of our spiritual roots when we share these insights. One final thing, as we listen to the experience of victims of racism, we must hear both the pain and anger of past memory and present reality. Miroslav Volf's book, The End of Memory, wrestles with his story of having been tortured under the former Yugoslavian regime. Its emphasis is on reflection on oppressor and being oppressed. Much of what he writes is application to oppressor and oppressed in relation to racism. It is a duty to remember truthfully, to remember in order to empathize, and to remember for a redeemed future. It means we still affirm the claims of justice, but hope for the repair of damaged relationships. Right remembering, he says, remembering that is truthful and just, that heals individuals without injuring others, allows the past to motivate a just struggle and a grace-filled world of reconciliation. We still have a long way to go in that just struggle and the grace-filled world of reconciliation. Thank you.